Good morning. Good to see everybody in the house of the Lord today, and we're excited as just a great day in the Lord. And looking forward today, we've got Pastor and Painter, Brother J.J. Cox with us, and he's going to come share the gospel in a unique way. And some of you were here a couple years ago when Brother J.J. was with us, but he's back today, and so we just want to open up in a word of prayer this morning and let him come and share what God's laid on his heart. So let's pray. Father, as we gather in this house today, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for our ability to gather. Lord, for so long we've sometimes took that for granted, but God, we won't do that again. And so we thank you today that we can see brothers and sisters and friends who are gathered today. And we ask you now just to anoint Brother J.J., Lord, just use him as a vessel to carry forth your word, to proclaim your greatness, your goodness, and your mercy, and your grace. And we pray and ask these things in Jesus' name. And amen. So I'm going to ask Brother J.J. to come this morning. Welcome him.
It's an honor to be back. Thank you, Pastor, for having me. One more time, can we give the Lord a hand clap? Can we do that? So I guess since I know this is a different crowd from this morning, but since the last time I was here, God has been amazing. And, you know, we had a lot of people during Corona that said, I guess your ministry's done. And that was not the case. God actually opened it up even more. So we're being blessed. You know, we've got to go all over the country with what we do and still full-time ministry and love it. And a lot has happened. So last time I was here, my associate that I was his youth pastor for about six, 7 years, something like that. But I've had him some way or another ever since he's that tall, about that tall. This is Corey Campbell, and he goes everywhere with me. He's a young minister just starting off, and wave, Corey, you know. And I guess the big thing that happened is I got married. So November, this is my wife, Naomi Cox. So, you know, I've learned a few things. I didn't say this. She said, oh, gosh, here we go. But I've learned in the Bible that a woman, that whatever you give her, she takes it and multiplies it. If you give her a bachelor pad, she'll make a home. And if you give her groceries, she'll make a great meal. And if you give her grief, she'll make you sleep on the couch. No, I'm sorry. It's not happened yet. It's not going to, right? But it's an honor to be back here today. And, you know, she says, shakes her head at me. But if you've never seen me do this, the first thing I always tell when we go to church is some places will have me come for conferences just to paint. And I still tell them, you know, I do this painting. This is my worship. I'm not here to entertain you. I'm not here to put on a show. This is to see someone saved. And so, you know, I like to say the altar is always open. And we've had people there in the middle of paintings come up. And, you know, I'll stop painting. I'll pray with them. Because that's what it's about. It's not paint me a pretty picture. It's about, how, you know, we want to see someone saved. We want to go about my Father's business. And so that's what it's about. And so today, you know, at one time, this was the only way that I could worship. And so, you know, I couldn't, if you remember from last time, I couldn't speak until I was the age of 8. And how I communicated was through art, painting, and drawing. And so the Lord just kind of took it, and that's how I worship now. So, but if you have your Bibles, today I'm going to be in Jeremiah, and we're going to start in 18:1. So this is one of my favorite scriptures. I say that about all of them, but so if you're there, just say amen. So the Bible says, "The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, arise and go down to the potter's house and there I will cause thee to hear my words. Then the next verse, it says, then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrote a work on the wheel. And the vessel, this is verse 14, the vessel that he had made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. So he made it again, another vessel, as seemed good to the potter to make it. So if you would, worship a little bit with me today, and I want you to listen to the words of this song.
I see clearly now. I finished with me. You're not 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 finished with me. No, you're not. Oh, you're not finished. You're not finished with me. You're not finished with me. You're not finished with me. Oh, when I doubt it. Oh, and when I doubt it, Lord, remind me I'm wonderfully made. You're an artist and a potter. I'm the chemist and the clay. And I know nothing has been wasted. No failure or mistake. You're an artist and a potter. I'm the chemist. Making something beautiful. You're making something wonderful. You're making something beautiful in me. You're making something wonderful in me. My past doesn't scare you, Lord. You can use it all. Oh, it feels like a second chance. Feels like being born again. Lord, you know me. Lord, you know me. Lord, you know me. Oh, 'cause if it's not beautiful, you're not done with me. If it's not beautiful, you're not done with me. Oh, if it's not beautiful, you're not done with me. Oh, in my life. Oh, if it's not beautiful, you're not done with me. Oh, my past doesn't scare you, Lord. Oh, and if it's not beautiful, you're not. You're not done with me, Lord. Oh, if it's not beautiful, you're.
I'm glad he's not done with me yet. I don't know about you, but I'm still on the wheel. I don't got it all together. I don't know if I ever will. But that's okay, because my Father, he's making something beautiful. And I didn't give him nothing to work with, but he's making something beautiful. And so right now, I want to go into this word. This is what the Lord gives me when I paint these pictures. You know, They sometimes come out the way I want them to. Sometimes they're different. I never know which way it's going to go. But I know this is what the Lord had given me. I had read this scripture most of my life about where it says that I will cause thee to hear my word. And where the Lord told Jeremiah, you know, from the Lord saying, arise, go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause thee to hear my word. I love the fact that the word arise there, and I missed this morning, but the Lord deals with words with me. And arise means to change posture, to get up, to do something different. I love the fact that he's telling them to do something different. Go down, I will cause thee to hear my word. Go to the potter's house. Then he says, then I went down to the potter's house, and behold, he wrote a work on the wheel. So I want you to understand today that the word is going out, and it's been going out, and I love the word of God. And the world has heard the word, and they have heard the word, and they have heard the word. But there's another part to hearing the word. And if you read this scripture, he says, I will cause thee to hear my word. But then if you go to the next verse, it says, behold, he wrote a work on the wheel. So he goes from just hearing the word to seeing the word. That's how I learn, is seeing. But I got to thinking about that. These people in the world that we're telling that God loved you so much, he gave his only begotten son for you. God loves you. But they can't see the love of God for them in you. So how about if instead of the world just hearing about the word, they see the word and hear the word in us? Because the Bible says greater is he that's within you than he that's within the world. So if you're telling someone that's not saved about the Lord and about the love of the Lord, how can you do that if they can't tell you love them also? And so I tell everywhere I go, I like to tell them myself. Because the way the Lord teaches me is a lot of times is things I see. And, you know, I told you last time I was here, the way I learn is I'm a vision person. And the Lord, you know, I had a long list of things that the doctor said I'd never do. And the Lord healed me of everything except for ADHD. So the way I learn is if I've got it in my hands, if I see it, I got it. And so a lot of times I'll be reading the word, and I'll begin to draw, and the Lord will give me, you know, a drawing for a scripture or a song. For I'll hear a song, and I'll begin to draw it. And I was reading this, and this is what the Lord gave me. And I tell everywhere I go, because, you know, I sometimes make people mad, apparently. But I run in to artists that's in the crowd sometimes, and if I offend you with things I say about certain techniques, you know, I apologize now, but. The Lord has been great to me, and I've got to try every medium of art. And I'm going to say this, there's one that I absolutely hate, and that is pottery. And it's not because it's not a beautiful art, it's because I can't do it. and I don't want to do it. I mean, I tried to do it. And being in art school, getting ready to graduate hopefully soon, you know, been working on it, and I've got the opportunity to do every type of art, and it's been amazing. And the Lord's opened that door for me, and you know, so about last year, you know, right before, I guess it was before Corona and everything, we had midterms, and it was real stressful. And I had a teacher, and it was in a class where we would draw and paint course. You know, that's my focus. And we had a teacher, and she said, we're going to do something different. We're going to help you relax. And she said, everybody put your projects down, and we're going, everybody walk with me. And we went up to this house. It looked like a little house on campus, and it is called the Pottery House. And I walked in. I'm like, uh-oh. Because I knew, you know, even in elementary school, my little daughters made a bowl that, you know, they wrapped coil around something, and, you know, and mine just leans over to the left. I never could do it. And we'll walk in this room, and in this room, there's shelves all the way around, and there's all these pots and sculptures that someone put a lot of time in. And I walked in, and I said, you know what? I thought to myself, I said, I preach about the pottery wheel. I talk about the pottery wheel. I've been drawing the pottery wheel. I said, so I'm going to do this. I'm going to learn how to do this. I'm going to do it. And I started looking, and I said, ooh, look at that one and that one. And I'm going to try that one, you know. And I got to looking, and she gives you a big block of clay this big. And, you know, we center in the wheel. And the first problem that I have is there's a gas pedal on it. That's what I call it. And she comes over, and it's a real nice woman. And one of my favorite teachers. I haven't ever seen her get frustrated yet. Until that day. And she said, just tap. Easy, easy. And I said, and it said, woof. And clay went up on the ceiling, on the wall, on her. And she said, you know, maybe you should just stick to drawing and painting. And so I'm like, thank you, I appreciate it, you know. And so I begin the process. And I sit down behind this lump of clay. And the first thing that I did is I put my thumbs in and pulled out. And I said, okay, I'm going to make something. I began working it up. And I said, okay, it kind of looks like a vase. And it fell over. And I said, all right, we're going to do it again. And I did that a couple of times, and it kept falling over. And she comes by, and she says, honey, you're trying to make something before it's time. She said, the clay's not ready to be made into that. And I got to thinking about how many times in my walk with Christ I was trying to do something. I was trying to walk in something that it wasn't time. You know, I like to tell people, if God can use finger painting, full-time ministry, God can use anything. And if God can use me, He can use anything. But I would have never have guessed that years and years and years ago. And what I love about God is when we put things in His hands, He does things we never could and we never thought could happen. And so what I found out is before you can do all those beautiful details and some of those pots had carvings in them, but before you can do that, there has to be an inside process first. You know, they were beautiful, but all of those pots had to go through this inside process first. And the first thing that we learned about was that the clay has to be worked and worked until the point that it's usable. And what that is putting in, pulling out, putting in. It's an aggressive process. And so what happens is, if you don't do that, there's imperfections in the clay. These little rocks get in the clay. And if you don't get them out, they begin to break. And little air bubbles get in there. And when you put the clay or the pot in the fire, it blows up in the fire. And I thought about how many times and how many Christians I knew blew up in the fire. Because they wanted to rush into something that they weren't ready for. And so I'm going through this process and I'm grumping. I don't know if y'all know what grumping is. I love coming here because some places we go, my wife's from Hopewell. And I don't know if y'all know where that's at. When I go there, they're like, talk for me. Talk for me. The pastor got up and said, when he talks, you're going to know he's from West Virginia. I said, no, I'm not. I'm from Bristol. There's a big difference. There's a big difference. So, but I love being able to say certain words, and y'all know what I'm saying. Don't look at me like, what's that mean? But I was sitting there, and I was like, I hate pottery. I hate pottery. I hate pottery. And so I went through this process, and I was working this clay. And I learned a couple of things. First of all, I learned there's a reason that's not my major, and that's why I don't want to mess with it. But then I learned that each piece, before it gets to the point up there where you can do anything to it, it has to go through this process. It has to be worked down. And so I kept working on this and working on this and working on this. And this big block of clay, it got smaller and smaller and smaller. And I raised my hand. I'm like, there's nothing there. And she said, now it's time to make something. Because you got rid of everything that didn't need to be there. Now it's usable. Now is the time. And so I began. Here I went. I began. Now, it wasn't what I wanted. It was a bowl and it was lopsided because that's all I could do was just pull out. At that point, I was ready to be done. And so here I go. And I'm pulling this bowl out. And I pulled it out to a point, and that thing came off the wheel. And I was holding it in my hand. And I was pretty mad. I was like, I did all that work and all that work to get this thing, this mush ready. It's just mush in my hands. And then I began to think about, God, what did you have to do to get me usable? What did you have to do to get me to the point where you could use me? And then the Lord began speaking. Because I had read this. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter. And so the Lord dealt with me. Ever have one of those moments where the Lord, it ain't always an audible voice. Sometimes it's just a still small voice. Sometimes it's just something happens and you know it was God. At that point, the Lord dealt with me and said, look. And I looked. And even though this piece of clay was broke off, even though I had ruined what I was making, even though it was mushed up, it was in my hand. It was still in the hand of the potter. I got a little excited because I got to thinking, even when I'm broken, even when I may be off the wheel, even where I'm in a place where there's times I shouldn't be, but even though I'm there, I'm still in the hand of the potter. And the Bible tells us, what does it say? It was marred in the hand of the potter, so he made it again, another vessel, as seemed good to the potter to make it. So if you're in that place today, guess what? He's not finished yet. Guess what? He's still making something out of nothing, because you know, I didn't give him nothing to make anything out of. And so here I am holding this. And the teacher said, I want you to know that when clay is marred, when it's like that, it's usable. When the clay is marred, that's not the end. That's the beginning. Because now you're ready to make something. So I got to thinking about what God had to do to get me to a point where he could make something. And I'm amazed by God. And so, you know, the Lord gave me this message. And I was in a place, and I was still on the pastor. I was in a place, and it is a what you call a liberal arts school. And I see everything and anything every day. And I've learned a couple of things. I've had pastors that when the opportunity opened up, there was preachers said, you don't want to do that. You don't want to do that. That's not where you want to be. But I liked Billy Graham. He said it best. They tried to trick him on an interview, and that's exactly what they were doing. They said, if you could set your tent up, some of you may know this quote. They asked him, they said, how far away from Hell's Gates would you set it up? And Billy Graham, he done that smile that he does. He said, I would like to set it up behind the gate in hell because those people need Jesus the most. And so what I've learned is in a place where they say God is not there, your light is a lot brighter when it's darker. In a place they say that God is not there, and that's where I go to school, God speaks to me the most. In fact, I have gotten more of these paintings during class, and I'm supposed to be paying attention. I'll tell myself. But I'm supposed to be paying attention. I've gotten more of these paintings during class than in church. And so, but the Lord had given me this message. And, you know, the potter's wheel. And this is new. This is probably about the third week I've done it. And they're all a little bit different. But what had happened is, the first verse, the word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord saying, arise and go down to the potter's house, and I will cause thee to hear my word. When I started reading that, you know, I've read that since I was a little kid. But in school, I met somebody. And I was in a class. And in this class, he said the one thing you don't want to hear in our school. He said, today I'm going to put you with a critique partner, someone that's getting ready to graduate. What that means, if you don't know, is that means they're going to tell you everything that's wrong in your piece. You stink and you shouldn't be here. That's what they do. And they think that's going to help you improve. They think that it's a tear you down to build you up thing. And so I'm like, okay, if I've got to do this, I did the Christian thing. I went around the room, and, you know, like I said, I'm still on the wheel. God's still working on me. But, you know, sometimes God will let you know where you're at, and where you're at isn't where you thought you would be. Come on. Where you're at is not where you think you are. I'm going to tell you that right now. Because God has a way of humbling you, and he did. And so I went around the room doing the Christian thing. I said, okay, God, she would be fine, he would be fine, he would be fine, she'd be fine. Anybody really in this classroom? But over here to the left was this young man, and he had these shoes on. They were high heels, and he was this much taller than me, and he had an alternative lifestyle. And I said, okay, God, anybody here, this section, here, no. God, no. No, God, no. And, you know how God works. So he goes down alphabetical. He goes, okay, Mr. Cox, right over here, he's your partner. He stands up, and he's that tall because these shoes are this big. And I said, God, I thought in my mind, I said, God, you got jokes. You're so funny, Lord. You're so funny. And so we went, I had to meet this young man at the library. I walk in the library, and I get ready for it. Because the Bible says, this is what I had to unlearn. The Bible says the Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. Just because it's sharper than any two-edged sword doesn't mean you should go cutting on people. So I got Scripture ready. I was going to tell this young man, not Jesus loves you, but I was going to unload on him about his lifestyle. I was going to unload on him what you must do to be born again. I got it ready. I was going to shotgun blast him. That's the words that went through my head. I'm going to give him both barrels. That's the word. We say that in Tennessee. I'm going to give him both barrels. That's what I was going to do. I walked in the library, had my Bible under my arm, and I said, literally in my mind, I said, preaching mode, activate. And I seen him. That's what I said. I was ready. I was tore up. I was ready. And I looked around, and I couldn't miss this young man. I'm not being mean. Very glittery shirt that was sparkling, and I could not miss him. I seen this young man sitting over there. And I was like, okay, I'm going to go up. And I sit down at the table. And the Lord began dealing with me to be quiet. Be quiet. Be quiet. That's exactly what I felt in my spirit. This young man began to quote the scriptures to me that I was going to blast him with. This young man told me what the Word said about his lifestyle. This young man told me what you must do to be born again. This young man told me the scripture, and really better than a lot of Christians I know could quote it without it being in front of them. I know he said it better than me. I have my Bible because I was going to open up because I can't memorize stuff that good. And this young man was saying it word for word because, you see, this young man was a pastor's son. And he told me, he said, I had the same options as you did. Mr. Pastor Painter, because he looked me up on Facebook. I didn't think he'd do that. I went there and I was going to blast him, and he was checking on me. And this young man, I began seeing not someone I wanted to tell, you're going to hell, but a broken young man, a confused young man, a young man that Jesus died for just as much as he died for me, that Jesus loved him just as much as he loved me. I begin to see a young man that had heard the Word but never seen the Word. And this is what God began dealing with me. God began dealing with me not to just tell him about the love of God, but to show him the love so he could hear the Word and see the Word. He said something to me. He said, see, at my father's church, I know these scriptures because anytime I go there, they start preaching on this. Anytime I step in. He said, I never see my family smile. He said, I thought Christians were supposed to be happy. And here, I was going to go in and do the same thing. Both barrels. I was going to give this young man everything that I could give him like that in one breath. I was going to let him have it. And the Lord began correcting me. You heard it. Correcting me. Well, he's not dealing with him. No, he may have been dealing with him, but he was dealing with me. Because if I had said anything, then he heard the Word, but he didn't see it. He definitely didn't see it in me. You see how that works? And so I wanted him to know that not only did God love him, but I love him. And so I got to know this young man. And over a year, you know, he graduated and he says, "Are you still using me to preach?" I'm like, "Yeah." He knows it. And he's come to a couple of services and watched me paint. And what I want you to know is we tell the world that we serve a God that loves you so much, he gave his only begotten son. And then we tell them, Jesus loves you. But the question is, can you tell them that why you love them? Can you tell them that? Well, you know, I told one pastor, I said, yes, there's a hell and I believe in it. But couldn't we tell them there's a better way than hell? Couldn't we tell them you don't have to go to hell? Do we have to tell them, you dirty old sinner, you're going to hell? Do we have to tell them that? No, we can tell them that Jesus hated the sin, not the sinner. Come on. Can we give God a hand clap? That's the kind of God we serve. So, I thought about this verse in the Bible, and I love this story because I had read about where Saul become Paul. I'd read about that all my life, and there's some things with me I miss, and then I'll do a painting, and God will bring it out through the painting. And so, you guys, a lot of you know the story where Saul, he become Paul. He's one of the disciples of Jesus. He was one of the disciples, but first he wreaked havoc in the church. The Bible says it. They were running from this man because he was evil. They called him evil. They were afraid of him. And anytime he come, people were hiding. This is how bad this guy was. And on the road to Damascus, he had a God encounter. And I love that God will get your attention somehow. Just like he did with me in the library that day. When I was going to yell at this young man and tell him about his life, and God was turning around and used it to deal with me in my life. So here is Saul, and he's blinded and he can't see, and the Lord's dealing with him. And I love how God, everything works together. And so God is dealing with him, and he's telling him to go, and I'm going to have a man lay hands on you. And you're going to receive your sight. And this man was named Ananias. And see, we missed that. He's my favorite character in the Bible. And he's not a character, he's real, but I say that sometimes. But the Bible says in verse 13, you know, the Lord's telling Ananias, you're going to go lay hands on him. And Ananias says, and the Bible literally says, then Ananias answered the Lord. And, you know, he's saying, I have heard by many of this man how much evil he hath done to the saints of Jerusalem. I don't know about you, but I got some Ananiases in my life that can remember me, and they can't believe where I'm at now. They say the only way you could be doing what you're doing and you're not in jail is God. That's the only way. And so this is what is happening. This man has seen how much evil this man done, and God is telling him, I got plans for him. And he's like, I seen what he did. You haven't seen it. And so the Bible says in verse 15, but the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel for me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. That makes me excited, because that tells me I don't care how mean you've been, you can be a chosen vessel. I don't care where you've been, God got plans for you. And he calls him a vessel. He calls him a chosen vessel. I love the fact here that Saul could not change Saul. Man could not change Saul. But when he had a God encounter, God changed everything. What do you mean? I want you to listen to this, because here he's talking about how evil he is and how afraid he is. But God says, for I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. God's telling him, I've got these plans. And in this verse, he goes from this man that's wicked. And Ananias went his way and entered into the house. and putting his hand on him, said, "Brother Saul." What are you saying there? I'm saying that the same man that was calling him wicked, when God done a work, now he ain't wicked. He's a brother. He's a brother in Christ. He's not what he used to be. That's the God we serve. That's the God we serve. Man can't fix you. You can't fix you. But God can. God can. I tell people, we have a watch this kind of God. Because in my life, man has said, "You'll never do this. You'll never do that. You'll never, never, never." And God has said, "Watch this. Watch this. Watch this. Watch this." God says, "I'll take a disability and make ability." See, what I want you to know is he's not finished with you yet. He's not finished with you yet. And so, this young man I was telling you about, you know, I had heard a lot of things about him. But God made a way in the last year. You know, we talked. I hadn't seen him in a little while, but before he graduated, you know, like I was saying, he would come watch me paint. And I know God's doing a work. I know God's doing a move, and God's not finished with him yet. What am I saying? I'm saying with you today, no matter where you're at, God's not finished. Well, you don't know what I'm going through. I'm broken. I'm torn. Everything that can happen has went wrong. Has. Well, I got news for you. He's the God of the broken. In fact, the Bible tells us in Psalms 34 and 18, "The Lord is nigh unto them that are of broken heart, and saveth such as of a contrite spirit." So, what I love about this verse, it's amazing. I mean, Jim, you might be heartbroken right now. Everything may be apart in your life. Well, guess what? The Lord is nigh. The Lord is there. You may feel alone, but the Lord is there. So, one great thing that I've learned is I'm getting to learn different styles. And everything that I learn, it always can go with the Bible. Everything I learn, even in science classes, they get mad, but it all can go with the Bible. You know, one thing that I've been able to do, and the Lord has opened those doors, is learn about other cultures. And so I learned about this art style, and I have to pronounce this because it's hard, Kintsu. So Kintsu is a Japanese art. And I got to see it. This lady took one of these pots. The teacher took one of the pots that there was so much time and effort. And they had carved in it. And she brought it out. And she said, "You're not going to understand this, but you're going to love it." And she dropped it on the ground. And it was shattered. And I was thinking, "Oh, that's done. I'm going to go get the super glue. That's done." But she had a little pot over there. Kintsu is where the Japanese, they would break their pots and they would mend it back together with melted gold. And so you would have these cracks all in this vase would be filled with gold. So it was worth more when it come out broken than when it went in whole. What am I saying? I'm saying you don't feel like it right now, but you're worth more now than when you went in whole. Because when you come out, you're going to be stronger. When you come out, you're going to be finished. So I got to watch this piece that was shattered that I said had no use become a beautiful work of art that had more value before she dropped it. That's our God. That's the kind of God we serve. If you would you stand with me? I'm going to give this back to the pastor. I just want to say, I don't know where you are. Maybe you're like that pot that's shattered. Maybe you're broken in the hand of the potter. But that's my message to you today. You're still in the hand of the potter, and he's making something beautiful, and he's not finished with you yet. Come on,
Pastor. Amen. As Mary Beth comes and plays, just continue with what Pastor JJ said this morning. Where are you at? I guess that's what everything comes down to. I don't believe in accidents. I believe God places us right where he wants us. And maybe today that's the message to you, is that you've been going through a season, you've been going through a time of brokenness, and maybe you've been doing that without Christ. And maybe what you're beginning to see is God's been molding you to get you right into this place today that you could hear about His love and His grace and His mercy for you. So whether you're here with us or whether you're online, that question comes, have you accepted Christ? Have you chosen to allow Him to work in your life, to be the potter in your life? Maybe you've been trying all along and to fix your life, to get things in order, and it just keeps crumpling. You keep falling over. We'll put yourself in the hands of the Master today. For some of us, we're believers in here. Most of us who are in this church today, probably most of us who are listening today, are probably believers in Christ. And the word that sticks with me is people have heard the word, but have they seen you on the wheel? When you go outside of this church, when you're at home with your family and in the schools and in your places of business and your local community, do people hear the word? Or do they hear the word and see the word being lived out in your life? Make sure as believers that our life is on the table, that people can see that we're a work in place. And I think that's a challenge to us today. And so this morning for our time at the altar, I want to invite you, if you're here today and you've never accepted Jesus Christ, I hope you'll make that decision today to follow Him simply by admitting that you've sinned, believing that Christ died for you, believing that He rose on the third day, and committing your life to Him. And I'll be standing up front. Would love to pray with you there. If you're with us online, there'll be a link you can click on, and we'll get you information about that. For some of us who are believers today, maybe this is just an altar time for us to say, Lord, let me live out what You've called me to be. Or maybe it's just a time for you and your family to come to the altar and pray together. We open it up every Sunday for that. And so we hope you'll take advantage of that. But let's pray, and then we'll open the altar up. Father in heaven, Lord, in brokenness, we become usable. Father, for some of us today, our humility is where it's got to come into play. Maybe we've been trying to fix our lives. Maybe we've been trying to get things in order. And Lord, You're the Master who knows what the clay needs. And so, Lord, we surrender to that today, whether it be salvation or whether it be a calling on our life. Lord, we submit to You. I pray in this place today, if there are any lost or any listening today that are lost, that today would be that day of salvation, Lord, that You make all things beautiful. And so we pray for a work to be done, and we ask it in Jesus' name, and amen. If you need to come this morning, altars are open. It's just a prayer. If you have a prayer need, just come let me know. Love to pray with you. Thank you. Amen. Thank you for coming to the house of the Lord today. Just a few quick things. Pastor JJ, if you go out these doors when we close out, he's got a little table set up out there with some things at it, and also an opportunity to stop by and visit with him and his wife and his minister assistant there. So encourage you to do that. Secondly, do want to let you know next Saturday is KOZ Saturday. We will be taking the boys over to Trout Pond there at Tazewell. So they need to be here at church at 9 o'clock. And that's ages 8 to 18. And sadly, we will have to ID for that because we've had several men buy an Oshkosh, putting their caps on sideways. So, but ages 8 to 18, you're definitely welcome to come to with us to that. It's going to be a great time, Lord. Also, this Wednesday, we will have our deacons meeting at 6 o'clock. And so all deacons, please make note of that. And I hope you have a great day in the Lord today. And as you are blessed as you go out today, I hope you take advantage of this beautiful weather and minister to somebody. And be sure to stop by and say hey to JJ. And I'm going to ask Timmy Bilter if he closes out in word of prayer today.